Thank you. Good evening, everyone, and the board wants to welcome all of you to tonight's Board of Ed meeting being held in the town chambers. The date is Tuesday, February 28th, 2017. I want to remind you that this meeting is being recorded and to please turn off all cell phones. Ellie, will you please do our roll call?
Good evening, everyone. Mr. Cassio.
Present.
Mrs. Fitzpatrick.
Present.
Mr. Forrest.
Here.
Mr. Hill.
Here.
Ms. Moon.
Here.
Mrs. Paradise. Mrs. Vazel.
Present.
Vice Chairperson Mr. Morris.
Here.
Chairperson Mrs. Granato.
Present.
And Wethersfield High School Student Representative Mr. Jack Breton.
Here.
All present.
Thank you. I would like Emily Almeida to come up to the front and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Emily. So good to see you. Mr. Emmett, I always look forward to our student and staff recognition. Do we have some tonight?
We do. We have a couple of items this evening, Madam Chair. If I could please have Monique Gardone from the Hunger Action Team come up to the podium.
Hi, everybody. My name is Monique Gardone, and I'm a senior at the Wethersfield High School. As he said, I am the student representative on the Hunger Action Team. In November, I was presented with two things, one fact and one challenge. The fact I was given was that in Wethersfield, our breakfast program participation is shockingly low. The challenge I was given was to fix that. Since then, I've been working with Ms. Duggins, a sociology teacher at the high school, to create a presentation of sorts to go to the high school or the elementary schools and present and play with the kids and eat breakfast with them and just make eating breakfast cool again. So our trips that we have proposed is an hour-long presentation with three 20-minute blocks. The first 20-minute block will be a verbal presentation. It was supposed to be a lecture of sorts, educating them about the benefits of eating breakfast, but we recently had a student who attends the Greater Hartford Academy of the Arts join our project, and so he's now writing a skit for us to perform for the students, which is an exciting new development. Next, we're going to play some games because we don't want the kids sitting there for an hour just bored out of their minds while we talk at them. We've crafted some games focused on making healthy choices, how to recognize unhealthy foods. They'll be doing jumping jacks, running around, just having a good time. And we will be eating breakfast with the kids, showing them that the high schoolers like to eat breakfast, and if the high schoolers like to do it, like, then everybody should like to do it. It should be buffet style. Hopefully we'll cycle the entire school through. We have students working to craft the menu. We have cultural options. We have just every type of food, hopefully to suit every picky eater. So we'll try to do that. So to make these trips possible, I've been doing an independent study with Ms. Duggins and her first period class. I've been educating the students about hunger, specifically hunger in Wethersfield, the causes of it. And we've been brainstorming ways to end it, just all of that. To prepare the trips, we have broken up into four separate groups. The first group that we broke up into is the visual group, which are focused on the aesthetics of the trip. They're planning posters. If the kids are dressing up, like if the high schoolers are dressing up in costumes, we have people who want to dress up as the eagle, the orange. Are we wearing color-coordinated shirts to match the food groups? Like, there's no really limit to what they do. It's just make our trips happy and pretty. The next group is probably the largest and what I find to be the most important group of what we're doing is the education group. And they have three subgroups. The first group is the students, and they are working on what we're going to do for the verbal presentation and how we're going to, like, word that breakfast is beneficial. The second one is the parents group. We're crafting a handout to send home to the parents explaining what we're doing and also the benefits of eating breakfast and how it could benefit their kids. And the third subgroup is for the teachers, because I didn't want to walk into the schools and just be like, well, you need to listen to us now. So it's either going to be an email or some sort of thing to communicate with the teachers our mission and that we're here to help, not to boss around. The next group is the games group, the kids making the games. All of these games are made up by the high schoolers. It is not something we found online. So it's all pure brain power, which I'm very proud of them for. And then the food group, which is analyzing what kids like to eat, what they'll eat for breakfast. They're researching different cultural options we could possibly provide at the school. And they're working with Jamie Davies, which is our the director of dining services for the Wethersfield Public Schools. And so all of that is going on. And our trips are going to begin March 17th. And they will be every other day, so like it's hard to explain, but I will have an official calendar ready probably by Wednesday, which I will share with Polly Moon, because we're on the Hunger Action Team together, and hopefully she can share with all of you. And you guys are all invited to attend these meetings and the presentations and everything, because it was brought up that there might be an interest, and I just thought the more the merrier. So come on down. It should be, mid-March through the end of April. So that's what's going on.
Thank you, Monique. Are there any questions to ask Monique? Diane?
Are you going to come back and report to us after the program?
If you would like.
Yeah, we'd love it.
That would be a great idea. Are you transitioning this into, like, a capstone project at the high school?
No, I think I'm past the ability to do a capstone project. I'm just doing it because I enjoy it.
Okay.
Well, this is like a capstone, so congratulations. It's a lot of work.
An honorary capstone.
Yes.
I think this is an excellent example of what a capstone is.
Anyone else? Okay, Monique, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you,
please,
Monique.
Come back. Thank you.
This time, if I could please have Mr. Glenn Horder, principal at Charles Wright, come forward to talk about exploratory classes at Charles Wright.
I believe it'll take a second for the screen to come down. Good evening, everyone, and all our high school students as well. At Charles Wright, we've started, just like all the other schools, with our school improvement plan focusing on academic achievement, problem solving, and civic responsibility. We're also focusing on leveled leadership. It's not about my leadership, but the leadership of our teachers taking ownership of where our building is going. So in August, we brainstormed, where do we want our building to go? What is in the best interest of some of our students? And let's think outside of the box and make things happen. And so this journey tonight that I'm sharing is where we began and where we are to now. Hopefully later, our students will come back and report what they think of these. Many of these suggestions for exploratory classes have been brought to us by the students, and they continue to give us many more ideas. Charles Wright Elementary School, our exploratories. Is the lamp on?
Yep.
No Star Wars music with this?
No Star Wars, you just have to read it.
Do you want us to hum along?
No.
Thank you.
The best part of the growth mindset exploratory class is having the opportunity to teach the children the difference between fixed and growth mindset, and seeing those kids then turn their attitudes around when they are struggling and using a more positive growth mindset when they encounter struggles in their educational lives and even outside of the school.
The best part of the exploratory class was the final results. The kids learned a lot, and they were actually able to put in practice what they learned, and also gave my wife, Donna, a chance to not have to do everything.
I have found that students who have enrolled in the exploratory art program have flourished when given this opportunity to further develop their art abilities. Whether it's learning new materials or techniques around the art room, or exploring their personal expression to discover what makes them special. It's also, I found, a great way to connect to a growth mindset, and students really love to embrace happy accidents, and they have a blast. They just come in with smiles and they leave with smiles. It's a great way to start the day.
Throughout the school year, I have had the opportunity to teach and to oversee many of the exploratory classes. In all settings, I have noticed that students have been enthusiastically engaged in their learning activities. I am currently teaching beginning band, which is offered as part of the spring exploratory sessions. In the future, I hope to offer vocal experiences to those students interested in developing their vocal performance skills.
Exploratories offer me the opportunity to see what the kids need during class and dig a little deeper with it during their extra time in exploratory.
The benefits of exploratory from my perspective as a classroom teacher, there are a few. Number one, the students are really responding to having the choice as to the type of activity that they want to be engaged in. And secondly, it has eliminated the pullout for band and orchestra at a time of day where it makes it difficult for me to offer instruction to all students. So having those students have their orchestra and band time during exploratory means I have more time where I have all of my kids in front of me ready for instruction.
So that's where we are at Charles Wright right now. Sorry about the sound mix up there. It wasn't like that before I arrived here. But the goal in the end is giving all our students the right amount of instructional time. And band and orchestra for years has been right smack during reading for our sixth graders, 2 days a week, band and orchestra. By moving them up into the teacher's planning time, we've enabled not only band and orchestra to function, but then gave all these other options that students have asked for. So it's a win-win. So we'll give you more information in the future. Any questions?
Any questions, anyone? Janet?
I'm just a little confused. So what are you trying to accomplish by doing this? Are you trying
more
to
instructional time for the
so
classroom
teacher?
So are
we eliminating chorus altogether?
Absolutely not. We have chorus. You saw the pictures, the chorus, and everything up there.
And what are the grades that this is affecting?
Fifth and sixth grade.
So when are they getting their chorus time in?
During their music classes, and then before performances, they have 3 to 4 rehearsals all together to rehearse.
And how will this affect the fifth and sixth graders if when they go into seventh grade, they need to be prepared for chorus? Will they be up to the level and the standards that they need to be?
Oh, absolutely. They sing in 3-part harmonies, and it's taught in the classrooms, and I invite you all to come to spring concerts, and you'll see it all work.
Was this a pilot you heard of before, or did you just start it yourself?
The school started it, the staff, trying to solve out a problem situation. And it is a pilot just for this year at this point.
And are you collecting data so that you can report back to us on how?
Absolutely. We've already done student surveys and staff surveys. 100% of the staff want to continue. 100% of the students want to continue. And the surveys are going out for parents next.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Holly?
That was great.
Thank
by
you.
The way.
Sorry about the sound.
Well, you know.
That's right.
it's still, My question is, how much time, so you actually set aside a separate time for this
well,
activity,
teachers
or
have,
is it built into the day?
Okay, teachers have 45 minutes of planning time each
okay.
day.
Yeah.
And it used to be set aside that band and orchestra wasn't during that time. It was during their, like for our sixth graders, during reading on Thursdays and Fridays. And if you're doing workshop, the amount of chunk that that takes out of that time and not knowing where students are and making up was a challenge. And even for the band students, they've all commented that it's so nice not to have to be penalized almost for coming out for band and orchestra and yet missing the classes and have to make them up.
So what you're doing then is holding those activities during the
during
that 45
the teacher planning time,
time
when
oh,
they go
okay.
out for art, music, PE,
right.
and then we've added 2 days. And many of our students now get PE, those who love PE, mm-hmm. they get it twice every single week.
Oh, nice.
Those who like art get it twice every single week. And those who want to be in, for example, as they move forward on a show choir type of experience, then they'll get both the chorus through the classroom and the show choir experience on Thursdays. And then we've even made sure that our fifth and sixth graders who are new band students, that the junior band is scheduled also at the exact same time. So our fifth and sixth graders just began, who are new to instruments, also do it right at that same time.
Oh, great. Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Anyone else? Matt?
Yeah. Where do we begin? So this is, first of all, I want to thank you for being thoughtful about the scheduling and trying to provide the children with the most instructional time that they can with the teachers. And I mean, when we were on the professional development committee, part of it was the whole pull-out conundrum of having kids go in and out of elementary school classrooms and even other classrooms without having good, solid blocks of time for the teachers to do exactly what they do best, which is teach. And we were running into all kinds of scheduling discussions and issues, and this is something that we've sort of talked about, how to fix the schedule so that it works the most efficiently for the teachers. And I'm just so thrilled to see this, because this is like the second layer of when we talked about adjusting professional development to allow teachers to do their jobs, kids to learn the best time, and using the best efficiency of this time schedule that we have. Clearly there was improvements that could have been made. Now we have a principal who's presenting an idea for his school that works. And that's just exactly the kind of stuff that we talk about on this board. When we talk to administration, we talk to the teachers directly, when we talk to the students, let's fix it. So thank you, awesome.
You're welcome.
And I just love to hear even more of these ideas coming to fruition. We'll pilot it, we'll see if it works, of course, if there's any hiccups, but this is the kind of innovation that I kind of expect. And when you see it, it's even that much better. So.
I do want to caution that this program is only possible because of the talents at Charles Wright. Every building is totally different, how the schedules work,
sure.
and everything like that. So this was just for us to see what can we do for our students at Charles Wright.
Okay. John?
Yep. Thank you very much for being creative. I'm happy to hear that it's not going to interfere with students entering the seventh grade for their chorus and the band there.
At
this point, hopefully it'll enhance and allow them. And, have you collaborated with the middle school at all on the programming that you're doing?
No, because our program really hasn't changed.
Okay.
As far as the choral program we present, it's the same that Donna Hookie has been presenting for years.
Thank you.
Thank
okay,
you.
Thank you, Glenn. Okay, next on tonight's agenda is the approval of the minutes of our regular Board of Ed meeting on February 14th, 2017. Are there any corrections? May I have a motion to approve these minutes?
Move to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? Those minutes are approved. Is there anyone wishing to make a public comment Please come on up to the podium and state your name and address, and may I remind you that we do have a 5-minute limit.
Good evening. My name is Dan O'Connor. I live at 49 Broad Street, and I'm here tonight to speak on behalf of the Wethersfield Youth Lacrosse Program. I am president of that organization and one of the co-founders. Earlier this year, I, along with several of our board members, appeared before this very body asking you to include in your budget a lacrosse program for the high school. Subsequently, we have met on multiple occasions with board members, the superintendent of schools, the principal, and even the athletic director. In each of those cases, the meetings have been incredibly productive, and the administration and board members I have spoken to have shown nothing but support for a lacrosse program. So if that's the case, then why am I here? The board is faced with a very difficult budget year. State funding is unknown and limited, and there are only so many dollars to go around. Based on this uncertainty, the board has had little choice but to propose a no new programs budget. I understand that and respect you for being fiscally responsible. Tonight, I ask you to continue being fiscally responsible while at the same time trying to find a way to fund this program, regardless of what happens at the state and our local level. I've asked members of our lacrosse family to attend tonight to show you that despite budget shortfalls, we are a committed group and wish to work with you to find a way to get this program into the high school. I had prepared this long laundry list of reasons why we should be offering lacrosse at the high school. However, after my meeting earlier today with Superintendent Emmett, Principal Moore, Athletic Director Maltese, and Board Member Kevin Hill, I feel as if I went through it, I'd be really preaching to the choir. And so what does that mean? What I would like to ask tonight is, as you can see, there are a lot of people here in the public that have come out tonight to show you they support having a lacrosse program at the high school. Rather than us focusing on the cost of the program, I would leave that to you to find a way to fund that program, and I would ask you for advice at the end of public comments on what we can do so this is a joint effort. All our meetings so far have been incredibly productive. We've had great optimism from both the board and the administration's office, as well as our board members in public. And so what I would like to ask you to do is, if we could, at the end of the meeting or at the end of public comments, if you could guide us and give us some direction on what is it going to take for this to become a reality. And for the students that are here, thank you for coming and taking part in our democratic process. I encourage you to come up here and tell them why you want to play lacrosse. But if you don't want to do that, you can stand up and let them know that you have several parents that vote. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan.
Good evening. My name is Lisa Puglielli. I live at 15 Quail Hill Road, and I'm new at this, so I'm nervous. Bear with me. I'm here tonight in support of the Distributive Education Club called DECA at Wethersfield High School. DECA is a business and marketing club for juniors and seniors at the high school who are interested in pursuing a career and are going to college for the business field. As part of the club, they do a project in the business field, and they present this project at a state competition. This year, the state competition is in 2 weeks, on March 13th. The winners of the state competition get the opportunity to compete at the national level. This is the pinnacle of the experience for the students in the club and an opportunity to represent their school at a national level. The students put together amazing projects. I brought some. They start work on them in September, and they work throughout the school year on their own time. This is not a class, and they perfect their presentations. The reports that they have submitted for this competition are in excess of 30 pages. They visit local businesses. They talk with business leaders. They design PowerPoint presentations to educate business leaders and employees about their topic. They go to local schools and teen centers. They create interactive games for students to participate in to teach them about their topic. They take 100-question standardized marketing tests for which they study on their own time aside from all the classes that they're taking. They create storyboards for presentations to the public. They learn new software as well as such important skills as leadership, teamwork, time management, and research skills. The club learned last Thursday that the funding for this year's national conference is in jeopardy of being cut. And I'm here tonight, along with several other DECA supporters, to plead with you to please not cut this amazing project from our kids for this year. Hundreds of hours have already been spent preparing for these projects. They compete in 2 weeks. They're told now that they can't attend the national conference, even if they win at the state level. The cost for the students to attend the conference is paid for by the families. The only cost to the school is the cost to send the chaperones. This amount is less than $4,000. The vast majority of the expense for this trip is self-funded. The school provides a very small percent of the whole trip. If the students had even an inkling that this funding was in jeopardy, they're business kids. They would have fundraised and brainstormed and found whatever way they needed to do to raise the money, and they would have started in September. But they found out 4 days later. Now, with 2 weeks to go before the state competition and 8 weeks before the national competition, it's like we're pulling the rug right out from under them. These are kids who have already done their part. They have put in the work, and they have spent endless hours preparing. And now it's up to us, the school and the town, to do our part. And how can we abandon them now? We should be congratulating them. We should be applauding their outstanding effort and skill. We should be running articles in the newspaper showing off what amazing things these kids are learning in our schools. These are people that we want to come back to our town and to build their businesses here and to raise their families here. We don't want to send the message that, you know, you can work as hard as you want in Wethersfield, but we're going to turn our back on you. For such a small investment, how can we not support them? I cannot stress enough that the work has already been done for these projects this year. 31 students are going to the state competition in 2 weeks. On average, the high school sends about 20 to the national competition each year, although I think it'd be great if they could send them all. A chaperone is needed for every 8 students. Letting them down by not funding this expense at this point is the same to me as saying to an entire AP class after they've already completed the class that they can't take the AP exam or get the college credit for the class because we won't pay for the test booklets. Or having the football team or the lacrosse team earn a spot in the championship game but then tell them they can't go because we won't pay for the bus. It's short-sighted, and I believe it's wrong. There are some DECA students here tonight. After the meeting, I would encourage you to talk to them about their projects. They'd love to talk to you and tell you that they've learned. Get an idea of the work and the learning and the amazing educational journey that they have undertaken to get this far. Or go to their competition on March 13th. It's at the AquaTurf. And watch them in action. As a town and as a school, we should be so proud of their achievements. We should be encouraging more students to follow in their footsteps and not abandoning them. Please do not let the funding for this project be cut. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Lisa.
Hi, good evening. Excuse me, I'm losing my voice. My name is Giovanna Ehrlich. I live at 12 Hunters Path, and I'm here in support with Dan O'Connor regarding Wethersfield lacrosse and Wethersfield. What an amazing turnout last week there was at the high school when a number of volunteers from the Wethersfield Youth Lacrosse Coaches came out to speak to the high school students about a rec team. There were about 30 students who came out with short notice to learn more about this movement. And I say movement because we are moving along. We had an enrollment last year of about 140 players, and currently at this time we have about 200 players within the town of Wethersfield that are looking forward to the 2017 youth program, just short of a year that we've been underway. As we continue to grow with lacrosse and make our movement, we are looking forward to the continued support that we have had so far with the Board of Education in improving lacrosse for the high school for the 2017 to 2018 school year. As I mentioned before at my previous opportunity to speak before the board, I was very passionate about telling you about my history of playing lacrosse and what lacrosse did for me. And with that being said, I will continue to say that lacrosse is a sport that promotes positive coaching and playing alliances, teamwork, problem-solving skills, and of course, that token growth mindset motto. In addition to that, lacrosse has taught me a number of 21st century skills that I've taken well beyond my high school college years and have used them today in my professional coaching as a teacher every day. I look forward and ask for your reconsideration to continue this movement in the 2017-2018 school year and bringing Wethersfield lacrosse to the high school. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Logan Lasalle, and I live at 32 Hartford Ave. I am a 7th grader at Celestine Middle School. This will be my second year playing lacrosse, and I enjoy it a lot. I would like the opportunity to play in the high school, and I ask for your support to make this happen so I can continue to play one of the sports I love. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Beth Gilbert, and I live at 42 Knight Street. I'm here in support of the DECA competition funding. I really just can't say enough how perfect the mom that spoke before put everything. I have a daughter who's a junior in participating in DECA this year, and along with her friend Jess there, they did a project that was beyond anything I could have imagined they were capable of even putting together. And them and all of the other students involved in this program under the direction of Ms. Riccardi, who is amazing, as if it's a facilitator of this program for them, you know, they're doing this all in their own time. How many teenagers do you know that would spend hours and hours and hours of their own time researching and learning and embracing this? I just, like she said, you want to say next year we're going to have an issue with the DECA funding, and next year they can put their heads together and fundraise and get themselves there because that's the kind of group of kids they are, that's fine. You say after a year's worth of work we're not going to support you, that's unacceptable. And I just truly hope everybody can see that and see their way to finding the funds. Again, relatively speaking, let's be honest, it's not a tremendous sum of money, and it's really the right thing to do. I know as a group, many of you, I'm sure, embrace the concept too of experiences being some of the most valuable learning, and this is a big one, for the good or the bad, and it's really in your hands. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Patrick Moller. I live at 281 Church Street, and I'm here to support the Dan O'Connor's Wethersfield lacrosse program. I have two children. One is at high school, just about to graduate, and one that's just started playing lacrosse. Mrs. Granato, you know both of them.
Oh, my goodness. He has to stand up. Where is he?
Kieran.
Hello, Kieran.
As a parent, what are the things that keep me in Wethersfield? Okay. Obviously, it's a fantastic school. All the school systems, the fantastic teachers, the sports programs, above all. The introduction of lacrosse last year really made this a very good opportunity for all of the kids to get stuck into something that's a little bit different from soccer, baseballs, and all the rest of it. Last year, we had children that never played lacrosse before, ever. Kieran's team, after having a few kids that never played before, ended up winning we had 8-2, right, Bruce?
Yeah.
Yeah. It was phenomenal to see the progress that these kids had made with very little time, with the dedication of Bruce and Dan and other coaches and parents that got stuck right into this program. We have an incredibly talented group of kids here in this town that will do Wethersfield proud if they get to play lacrosse at the high school level. We got a phenomenal recreation program. It'd be great to see it in the high school. I think Wethersfield, to parents that are coming into this town, needs to sort of create something that's going to make it a town that everybody would like to come to. I think we need to sell ourselves to people that are coming into Connecticut that are wondering where they're going to go. We've got the insurance industry in this in Hartford, to name a few, the aero industry. So where do they want to send their children? And I think if I'm a parent coming in here, I want to look at sports programs. What are my children going to do in the long term? How are they going to benefit in the long run? And I think the lacrosse program is a good thing for our town to have in the long run. And I fully support I'd like to see it go to the high school. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Tom Bianchi, 31 Stillwell Drive. I'm actually here for dual causes, both the DECA program and the lacrosse team, as I've got children that participate in both. I'll just echo in terms of my perspective from where Dan started. I think it's one of those things where, you know, we're just hoping you can be fiscally responsible and hopefully get these two programs done. I can tell you the DECA program is something where my son, some classes in school, he just doesn't get into, but the DECA program has really allowed him to take off and focus his concentration on some of his passions. I would say they have put in a ton of work from September till now. Secondly, on the lacrosse program, again, my other son, Brian, the enthusiasm that he has just to go to practice is ridiculous, which for most other sports, he loves them, but hates going to practice. And I just think with the lacrosse, this is really a very fast-growing sport that really at this point, it's, I think, more of an investment on the town's part. Because I can tell you, I'm probably going to be here. My younger son's in seventh grade, so I'll probably be here next year having the same discussion with you guys. So, again, I just support both programs, and I hope you do whatever you can. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Ryan Barazzi, 116 Charter Road. I'm a freshman at Wethersfield High School, and I'm here in support of the Wethersfield lacrosse program. I played last year, and I just want to say that it brought kids from different sports that we would not normally be teammates with, and it just kind of joined together. We had soccer players, football players, hockey players, and it just brought a whole new group of kids that would not normally hang out or play together, and it was great. We were successful, and I think that by having this program, it could do that for future kids and lacrosse players. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Justin Bianchi. I live at 31 Stewall Drive. I'm also here advocating for the DECA Business Club that I am currently a part of. The project that my partner and I have completed is entirely self-driven and self-supported. This project is very career-focused for me, and it teaches me things that I will be able to use in a future career in my field. The group understands the budget freeze that the budget freeze that was enacted, which withheld our funding that we've had since 2011. We plead with the board to please contribute at least some of the money that we need to attend the national conference in April, I think. Thank you so much, and thank you.
Thank you, Justin. Thank you.
My name is Bryn LaSalle, and I live at 32 Hartford Avenue. I'm currently a fifth grader at Hamner School, and I play lacrosse. I asked for any support to try and get lacrosse into the high school because I would like to have the opportunity to play lacrosse when I'm there. Thanks for your consideration.
Oh, thank you. Good girl.
Hi, my name is Sean Arquette. I live on 160 Hangdog Lane. I'm actually the president at the local DECA club for our chapter. I know one of the parents and a couple of the other parents and students have come up and talked to you about it. I don't know if you know much about it, but it is a business club that the students are completely self-driven on, and I've been in it for 2 years, and it's actually given me a direction on what I want to major in college. So I'm going to college to major in marketing, but my true passion when I was at school came from DECA. It was the most important thing, besides like regular grades and going to math class and all those classes. But DECA was something that I always like look forward to coming in the school year. And so last year I actually did a 30-page project with my partner Gina. And we also did a 30-page project this year. We came in fourth for the state level last year. And I learned so much. And although we were 1 point away from qualifying for nationals, I was chosen for the leadership position because we worked, hours on hours on hours with local businesses and such. And I actually went to Nashville, Tennessee to the national conference. And I don't want to say it was life-changing, but it was one of the better experiences I've ever had at the high school. I met people from, across the country. And there's people from Canada, Taiwan, places that you like couldn't even imagine that all like collectively came to one place in Nashville, and they really like showed one love, and that was DECA. It was a business club, and it was kind of nice to see that thousands and thousands of kids, I'm talking from like every state every state in the United States was there. And so this year, we did a 30-page project. We did it on a local business but the franchise Jimmy John's. And although it was a lot of hard work, we worked hours on hours doing this project, and we even road tripped up an hour and a half away to the nearest Jimmy John's to shoot a commercial. We have posters, we have the 30-page project. We have to do a 15-minute presentation, and I'm just asking you to not cut the funding if you can find the money possible. It was kind of shocking when I heard it because I wasn't really expecting it, but I don't understand too much about the money, but I'm just hoping that you can find it in your hearts to just see if you can find some money and bring some of the kids that qualify to go this year. That was our main goal, and that was to make it to California. So thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Bruce Cuckham. I'm from 332 Hartford Avenue, and I've been a Wethersfield resident all my life and participated in youth sports throughout this town my entire life. I've enjoyed every part of it, but I didn't have the opportunity to play lacrosse. I played at Newington growing up, and then from there, our high school didn't involve anything from there. So I went to Berlin. I had to bus myself, drive myself to games once I was able to, and it was a lot harder than you'd imagine getting around the state by myself without the bus to get with Berlin. These kids that I've coached the eighth grade team and now the high school team, the rec team this year, have the opportunity to play lacrosse. I played in college and it was the best time of my life. I still keep in touch with all those kids I've played with. It was some of the best family that I'll ever know. I want these kids to have that opportunity as well. They don't play another sport in the spring, maybe they do, but they're here because they support lacrosse and they love it. I'd just like you guys to really reach out and tell us what we need to do to fund this, because these kids deserve lacrosse in the high school. They've been here, they've given what they needed to do, and they really deserve it. So I'm hoping that you find the way to be fiscally responsible as well as any help that we can give you, because I'd love to see lacrosse in the high school and give these kids the opportunity that I didn't have when I was there. And on a side note, I was part of that DECA 2011 program, and we went to nationals, and they definitely deserve that experience as well.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Abby Sullivan, and I live at 62 Fairlane Drive, and I'm a junior at Wethersfield High School. I'm here to speak on behalf of the DECA funding. My partner Sarah and I have worked extremely hard on our financial literacy promotion project. This included a 30-page paper and many activities, including going to different schools, the Boy Scouts, teen centers, and local businesses that include people who we just gave presentations to and did games with them, and it really made an impact on our lives too, just doing the project. And this included a 30-page paper, which you can all have the opportunity to see at the end if you would like to. And we work on these projects completely outside of class, and we have worked extremely hard, just hours upon hours, spending our weekends together, doing the projects, planning, doing PowerPoints, and it's a very good thing. And Mr. Cardi, the leader of the whole program, is an amazing teacher, and she has assisted us and made an impact on all of our lives. Please do not cut the funding for the national competition. The experience is very valuable to us, and I truly hope it will be funded. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mariana Garcia. I live at 91 Windmill Hill. I'm a senior at Wethersfield High School. This is my second year in DECA. Last year, me and my partner won second place at the state conference, and there was no greater feeling than standing on that podium with our trophy representing Wethersfield. It was like the best experience of my entire high school career. DECA has taught me so many things, not just about business, but other areas too. I've learned how to, like, good research skills. I've learned social skills. You have to stand up in front of a judge and give your presentation, and that was the scariest thing in my entire life, but it taught me so much. It taught me just to relax. It taught me that I know my stuff, I know what to do, I know what to say. And then it also taught me that at the end they ask you questions. So it teaches you to like know stuff on your feet. You have to think quick, you have to know what you're talking about. And it's just the experiences that I've learned for DECA like will help me
the rest of my life with job interviews, with anything I have to do. So, and I want other people to have the same experience that I did, because going to Nationals in Nashville was the best experience ever. I met so many people. You would go into an elevator and you would say, oh, where are you from? I'm from Connecticut or California or people from Canada. And it was just the coolest thing ever. I think there was over 18,000 high school kids there, and it was the best experience. And I just hope that you'll give us somebody, and if not, maybe like find tell us ways that we can maybe fundraise. I know we don't have that much time, but we're really dedicated kids, and we really want to go to Nationals. Thank you.
Oh, you're wonderful. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Michelle Musello. I live at 100 Meadowview Drive. I'm the senior girls lacrosse coach. It's the 7th and 8th grade girls. I had a team of girls from soccer. I had a handful of girls that never played a sport. These girls went out there, they played hard. We won, we lost, we tied. It was an amazing experience for me, myself as a coach, for first-time coach, and for the girls who came around. They didn't know how to pass or cross. They had no clue about all the rules and regulations. All they wanted to talk about was when we were going to do it again, when our next game was, and am I going to coach next year? I said, I will. I surely will. This year, I have 31 seventh and eighth grade girls signed up. Okay, that's a huge amount. It's practically enough to make two teams. So all those eighth graders, which my daughter is going to be in the high school the following year, it's going to be very disappointing for her to not be able to play lacrosse as a sport. So I'm here speaking for everyone. It's a great program. I think that it does do a lot of bonding with all of the children from all different sports. My girls that never played a sport before love it and are all signed back up again this year. And as far as the DECA goes, what a fantastic opportunity. I'm all in favor. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Gail Arquette. I'm the mother of Sean Arquette. I live at 160 Hang Dog Lane. And not to be too repetitive of what's already been said, as a mother of a teenager, he loves to sleep on Sunday mornings. And I want to share with you that he and his partner awoke at 7:30 on a Sunday a.m. to drive to Worcester, Massachusetts. That's pretty incredible. As he mentioned, he did attend Nashville last year. Although we've traveled as a family, we don't travel too extensively. But to go to Nashville with his classmates, getting on an airplane allowed him to realize, I could go to any city to go to college. I want to do that. I love Wethersfield, but I want to broaden my horizons. He got there. He was ecstatic. He decided he doesn't want to go to Nashville, but he's chosen to go to another faraway city. And he would never have made that decision a year ago when it came time to apply to college had he not had this opportunity with DECA. He's a dedicated student, but like he said, DECA has really given him such great enthusiasm. And my husband is in an industry where they do a lot of advertising and marketing, and that's not who he is within the firm, but he did arrange to have the students come on a field trip and spend the day at his company. And they were so professional and so grateful. And what an opportunity for them to maybe shadow other people in their market, in the career place, and see what people do. Without DECA and without the enthusiasm of Mrs. Riccardi and of these kids, I don't think that his future or many of these other students might have the courage and the confidence to expand their horizons. One last thing. As was mentioned, this didn't come to their awareness until 4 days ago. The amount of money that they're asking is $4,000 for four chaperones. I will share with you as a parent, if they get this trip, he himself has to spend a lot of money to go. That money might be bonds. It's hardworking money that he's worked for and that he's counting on. And money that might be going to help pay for his college books and his textbooks or a big vacation. This is huge to them. To take it away from them now would really be sad. So I hope that we can find some way to help them raise the money or to grant them the money for this year so that next year the DECA students will have had more time to fundraise. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Dory Sargent. I live on 14 Willard Street. And I just want to speak on behalf of the lacrosse program as well. This year, my son is in middle school and he played lacrosse. And I have never seen such a passionate board and a passionate group of players. I didn't know much about it, but now I'm very excited about it. And I just have to say that it is an investment. I want to echo what somebody said earlier. My two nephews down in Texas just got scholarships. Down there, so it's one of the fastest growing sports in the country, so I do think it would be an investment for Wethersfield. Also, I'd be happy to work with anyone on writing grants, because we did get a grant for our youth program, so any guidance you can give us. I think you can see our board is very invested, so we'd be happy to help with anything you need, so thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Terry Raposo, and I live at 217 Griswold. The name might sound familiar because I might have hounded some of you with some emails in support of our lacrosse program, so go lacrosse. I just wanted to just reiterate what a lot of people are saying here. I think as an educator myself, and just listening to the board, I know that you want to remain competitive with our neighbors, particularly Glastonbury, Newington, and Rocky Hill, and I think you want to remain competitive academically as well as recreationally. So as you can see from the support here today, as well as there's a petition going around, in one day at a basketball tournament, we were able to receive at least over 100 signatures in support of that. And I think if we had more time and just some more grass movements, we would have been able to get a little bit more, but it is rotating around. I do think that you should try in any way that you can to either help us learn ways to fund it or fund it. Because again, we want this movement to be a reality and you can see the support here in that. So thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Cindy Zerblis, 119 Two Rod Highway. I'm here tonight to request that the board reconsider its decision to not include a lacrosse program for the high school in the budget. Currently in our state, there's about 175 schools that offer a lacrosse program at the high school level. Wethersfield's surrounded by many of these towns that offer lacrosse. I believe those 175 schools account for about 70% of the high schools in Connecticut. Why would we not want to be part of that 70%? If we want to make our town a place where people want to live and raise a family, then we must keep up with the Joneses. Otherwise, we'll be failing. My second reason for wanting this program is I believe it will benefit our students. It's a known fact that students who participate in sports end up benefiting tenfold from being part of a sports team. By participating in a sports team, our children learn about representing our community, teamwork, and cooperation. We saw this just last week when our freshman football players stood at this very podium as a team to speak about the importance of replacing the turf. They learn about the importance of fitness and how playing video games and participating in unhealthy behaviors such as smoking is not good for them. Also, students who participate in sporting teams are statistically known to have a higher GPA and better attendance because they are participating in sports versus those that do not participate. As a mother of a freshman football player, soon to be lacrosse player, thanks to Mr. O'Connor's work with the Parks and Rec staff, I watch my son, who I know struggles academically, put in the extra effort into his schoolwork because of football. If he didn't have football, I honestly don't think he would be doing as well as he is. Football is his main motivator. And you can ask him. He's sitting right there. He'll tell you every day. In addition... In addition,
stand up.
No, he doesn't.
He wants him to talk.
No, I'm just saying it is his motivator, and he'll tell you that. In addition, in this age of technologies, it teaches children social and leadership skills and time management skills. In today's world, all of our children, and even us who grew up without cell phones, well, maybe all of you, not me, but no, who grew up without cell phones and the internet, we've all started to lose touch with that face-to-face interaction with people. Everything is done by texting, email, video conferencing. I totally admit I'm guilty. I email my coworker that's 10 feet away from me all the time. And this teaches them to basically get up and participate face-to-face with one another, which is, it's important for them to learn that. They're not learning that as much as we did when we were growing up. And again, going back to the 70% of the Connecticut high schools, since all of those schools offer lacrosse, that means their students have more opportunity to apply for scholarships than our students do. In this day and age, in order to send a child to college, most people, they need to take out a second mortgage out on their home if they are lucky enough to have a home to take out a second mortgage on. So why would we not want to give our students the same opportunity that our surrounding towns offer their students? I realize in Wethersfield we have a great athletic program at the high school, but why would we not want to make it that much better? If we can just get one or two students to participate in lacrosse, and I think there was one woman that was just up here just said that her daughters didn't participate in sports and now they do because of a lacrosse. Why would we not want them to participate in a sport? And make it's a win-win for everybody to have that student participate. I'm hoping that you, again, will reconsider and please add the money back into the budget for the lacrosse program. It's in the best interest for all of you. Thank you. And as an added note, as I sit here and I've listened to these people from DECA, I just want to tell you a little bit about myself. And I mean, obviously, I graduated from Wethersfield High a long, long time ago, but I was part of the DECA program. And I'm going to say this even in front of my son. I was not a focused student in Wethersfield High School. I was probably, I'll admit this. I'll admit it right in front of my son. And I will say this much. The DECA program for me got me focused. And because of that program, I have my master's degree, and I have a very successful career. So I think it's very important that we do give that $4,000 as a drop in the bucket. And I didn't come here for DECA tonight, but when I heard some of these kids talk tonight, they deserve to have that money. They really do. It's a good thing for them. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Will McKenna, and I live at 89 Dudley Road. I am in fifth grade at Emerson Williams, and I am supporting lacrosse. I really would like to get to play lacrosse in high school. I hope you can put money together for lacrosse. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Todd Murphy, 41 Woodland Street, Wethersfield. I'm here to support the lacrosse program and any efforts we can make to have lacrosse in high school. I came tonight prepared to be indignant and bring down the wrath, you know, but Paul told me that you guys were so nice in your meetings and committed to working together. It kind of took all the wind out of my sails.
Sorry.
Yeah, so...
Yeah, John.
So I'll just make it as simple as I guess I can make it. Lacrosse good, no lacrosse bad. Thank you.
Thank you.
Paul Osella, 32, Hartford Ave. It's true, I did tell him that we had a great meeting this afternoon, and I know there's a lot of commitment to get lacrosse into the high school program. I just thought I'd share a couple of statistics with you guys. Right now we have 204 kids registered between K and 8th grade for both boys and girls, and that's up almost 55 from last year in that same age group. We also have 31 high school kids registered for our rec program. And that's 100% increase than we had in high school from last year because we didn't have a high school rec program. So in total, as of this afternoon, we have 235 or so kids registered for lacrosse in this town. It's important that we provide a place and an avenue, and so they don't leave our town or our high school to play in a private school or another town. We don't want everybody to go through what Bruce went through. I can just picture him driving around the state trying to get to different games and meeting up with his Berlin High team. And I ask for your continued support and whatever we can do. Also, I only came here tonight to talk about lacrosse, but as many others, the DECA program sounds pretty fantastic. And whatever we can do as a town and you can do as a board to support them getting to nationals, I am absolutely in support of that as well. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Chelsea Ventura, and I live at 53 Dix Road. So I wasn't really planning on talking tonight, but all of my classmates, I'm part of the DECA program, and I'm a junior at Wethersfield. This is my first year participating in DECA, and I've kind of had an idea what I wanted to do with my life after high school, but once I got started at DECA, there was all these options of what you could possibly do with marketing. And my partner and I, we chose fashion merchandising. And I remember we stayed after till like 6 one day with Mr. Carty, and I was telling her, I was like, Ms. Carty, we've been here since 2. I really want to leave, but I love this. Like, this is what I want to do with my life. This is what I'd rather spend 6 hours on rather than writing an essay for English. Sorry, all the English teachers. But that was what I wanted to do with my life. And I was really confused before this. And then I started doing DECA, and I started meeting all these people who I probably wouldn't be friends with if I wasn't part of DECA. And it's made me really decide what I want to do with my life. So I just think if you gave us a chance to prove ourselves, we can go to nationals. I don't even know if I'll make it to nationals, but I just want everyone else to get a chance to go, and just hope you reconsider. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, hi, my name is Caroline Butler. I live at 196 Fox Hill Road. I've been a Wethersfield resident for 9 years. I have 2 children, ages 9 and 14, who both play lacrosse. My son will be attending WHS next year as a freshman. He's played Newington lacrosse since 3rd grade. This will be his first year playing Wethersfield as an 8th grader. We as parents have been waiting for Wethersfield to develop a program for many years. We were very excited and grateful that Dan O'Connor developed a lacrosse league in our town. We anticipated there would be a high school team for next year. Once the town has a club team for 2 years, they can transition to a varsity league. Wethersfield currently has 235 kids who participate in lacrosse. My questions are, how can we have a feeder program and a no high school program, and how is it fair that kids can play other sports at WHS but not lacrosse? I just wanted to include a little bit of history because it seems, you know, odd that we're asking for a lacrosse program when lacrosse has been around for so long. I mean, the first college program was established in 1877, and then 100 years later in 1971 was the first men's lacrosse NCAA championship. It's not a new sport. There's more than 100 high schools currently in Connecticut that have it. Our surrounding towns have had high school lacrosse teams for many years. Rocky Hill transitioned from a club team in 2012. Newington's had their program since 1985, and Glastonbury 1983. We are behind the times. It seems unfair to tell our kids in town that certain kids can play field hockey or soccer, football, but you're not gonna play lacrosse. It's been such an up and coming sport, especially over the last decade. Our school kids deserve to have the team. Team sports provide kids with important lessons on personal values. Children who play team sports are less likely to feel isolated. Team sports can encourage parents to become more active with their kids. Team sports help kids deal with winning, losing, overcoming shyness, improving self-esteem, physical activity, mental health, and personal values, and help with making friends. There are many benefits to team sports, and they can lead to be playing beyond high school. The amount that was requested for lacrosse was approximately $50,000, 0.01% of the entire board budget. I do understand that they were asked to not have an increase in the budget, but it is a very small amount compared to the entire budget. Wethersfield residents are paying very high taxes. Wethersfield mill rate is 38, Newington's 35, Glastonbury 36, and Rocky Hill 29. We are paying the highest mill rate in the area, yet the town cannot afford to add lacrosse program for our children. Our population is 26,000, and of that, 20% of our children are under 18. We are asking the Board of Ed to add high school lacrosse as a line item for the 2017-2018 budget. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Luke Bresnahan. I live at 11 Woody Crest Road, and I'm here tonight in support of the high school lacrosse. I played lacrosse from 6th grade all the way to 8th grade, and I was heartbroken when we didn't have a high school team. And I am now a senior at the high school, and I would just love to be a part of the senior class that got lacrosse started at the Wethersfield High School. It's an amazing sport. It's so easy to set up. Like, we already have multiple fields. All we need to do is add a couple extra lines for the different boundaries of lacrosse. It's so easy to play, it's fun to play, and it's so easy just to pick up a stick and a lacrosse ball and throw it around with friends or bounce it off a wall, catch it. It's so much fun, and I think it would just be a bummer if we couldn't get it for next year. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. I'm sorry to say, you have to wait to the end of the board meeting to hear comments, but I'm sure, I know I have comments, and I'm sure the other board members have comments too. But we'll move on to our meeting, with our meeting. And Mr. Emmett, do you have any communication to share?
I do. Thank you and good evening, everyone. Thank you all for being here this evening. Greatly appreciative of having you here. I have a few items this evening that I wanted to speak about. Some of the parents had spoken about the issue of lacrosse this evening and talked about a meeting. I want to let you know, and I think I'm speaking on behalf of the board, that there's no one on this board, along with your superintendent, that does not want to see kids get an opportunity to expand their horizons. We know full well that lacrosse is an extraordinarily popular sport, and it's a growing sport. My own nephew plays it and absolutely loves it. Baseball went by the wayside. So we know it's an up-and-coming sport. So what we talked about today during our meeting was, how do we make it work? Because here's the other reality of it. The other reality is we are in an extraordinarily difficult budget time. And right now, tonight, the board will come together and will vote on a budget that increases the spending by 2.94%. That includes no new initiatives. And while I understand that you are all passionate about lacrosse, I'm also passionate about an ELL teacher that we need for the district. I'm passionate about a special ed teacher we need for the district. I'm passionate about a tutor that we need at the high school. And I'm passionate about additional social work time I need at the middle school. Those are all priorities. They didn't make it into the budget either. So in meeting today with several of the parents, we talked about how can we make this work? $50,000 is looking at a full-blown program, so let's start it as a club. Let's look at those options. So what we're exploring now at this point in time is a process where the parents, you're going to help. We're going to need to do this together. We're looking for ways financially where we can support the addition of coaches, a stipend to come at the freshman coach level. There was discussion about playing on a Catone field. At this point in time, it's not striped for Catone field. In addition to that, there's also the potential, I know the groundswell is coming, about replacing Catone field. The turf is kind of worn out. So you still have the opportunity for Cove Park. You still have the opportunity for the ladies over at Charles Wright. So that's a potential as well. We're also talking about the costs involved with referees. We're also talking about the issue of transportation. We may start a club, and transportation may be on you guys to start this process. But I think that it's safe to say that we are working toward getting this club up and off the ground. So we still have a lot of work. And again, I love the idea of picking up a ball and a stick and playing. We also have to look at it from the perspective of what the insurance looks like and what impact that'll have. But I want to be clear with all of you this evening that we are supportive of this process of developing a lacrosse program. So we're going to continue to meet with the parents. Mr. O'Connor, thank you for your efforts in being there today, along with the other parents that were present. And we're going to work to develop this program and get it in place. The other aspect I want to talk about tonight is the issue with the DECA program. I will tell you, I've been superintendent for 5 years. I've been in this district for 8, and I have been overwhelmed by the quality of the work that the DECA group has provided. I've seen the DECA groups come here after the nationals and present their projects. Nothing short of phenomenal. And it's one of those things that we talk about that, you know, we talk about the fabric of Wethersfield. That's what DECA is. Here's the other reality. The other reality right now is that we're in a budget freeze. And this budget freeze has been in place for the last few months. We've been running a deficit, and we need to be extraordinarily careful to make sure that we have enough money at the end of the year to finish up. We're currently working with the town with a component called the minimum budget requirement, and we're hopeful that that minimum budget requirement, once it has been rectified in conjunction with town and Board of Ed, will be able to free up the funds. So again, I make no promises yet, but we're working on that. A couple of other items this evening. Just so you know, the state today released the Next Generation State Accountability Report for 2015-2016. I am extraordinarily proud to report that Hanmer Elementary School is one of only 116 schools in the entire state of Connecticut that was listed today as a school of distinction for its growth in the area of student achievement. So extraordinarily proud of that. You can access the information for the accountability report on the state website. Encourage you to do so. Board of Ed members, we just got this information this afternoon, so we'll have further information out to you in the Friday update. Beyond that, with our winter sports, we're now entering playoff season. I know the ladies basketball team is out in Newtown playing this evening. I know boys are scheduled in the next week or so. We've also had an extraordinarily positive year with our dance team, award winners there. And our hockey team has come back from the brink and actually ranked number 2 in Division 3. So we've got a lot of great work going on. Had the opportunity to go and visit the pool last week. Pool is up and running, doing quite well. I know it was senior night for the boys. So a lot going on. And in addition to that, we'll be heading into the spring season and we'll be talking about spring sports. So again, the other thing I would say also, with your passion and you coming up here and speaking your mind, that's an important piece. And we're going to continue to need this support as we move forward in this budget process. So appreciate your passion and your commitment. Thanks for being here tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we're moving on to action items, and tonight we have many recommended motions under action item 6A. So I've asked Sally Destoli to please come up and give us some more background on these curriculum changes in our high school. Sally?
Good evening. So on behalf of the teachers in the CTE area, the business, technology, engineering, and family consumer science, Dr. Suarez, instructional supervisor for STEM and the high school administration, we're bringing forward many course changes in the CTE area. So these are really coupled related to the brand new facility we have at the high school, state-of-the-art equipment. We have several new staff members that have joined the department that have brought really specific interests and expertise. Some of them have expertise in the industry, and they've also spent the time to research and talk to experts within the industry to make some recommendations towards the course, the software, and the materials used. We also have, with the new renovations, a large influx of technology. The TV studio, if you haven't seen our Blue Eagle production, it's a great video clip and program. We have a state-of-the-art kitchen. If you visit some other high schools, they have kind of our, what I would call a kitchen high school, but we have industrial state-of-the-art kitchen equipment. And our tech room is renovated to support the engineering practices and equipment necessary. So as we look at the program offerings at the high school and our work to help students become college and career ready, explore different passions. We look at our national and even state statistics on the demand for more STEM graduates and people interested in the STEM careers. Our department teachers put their heads together and provided some proposals to update, modernize, and change the courses based upon their skills, the facilities, and also the interests of students. So before you tonight is a rationale from both the Technology Education Department and also the Family Consumer Science Department outlining some of the courses, some of the things they're exploring. So the courses, the different departments are also working on a partnership with Capital Community College so that students that complete certain courses could actually get a transcript from Capital Community College. The nice piece about that is there is actually no cost to students involved in that. So the teachers have reached out and working through that. Today in front of you will be course proposal changes, the addition of some courses and the deletion of other courses related to the kind of background that I've provided.
Thank you, Sally. And this was all discussed in Student Program and Services, chaired by Diane. So Diane, would you, and we're gonna do them one at a time now, would you do the first recommended motion under action item 6A?
Sure. Move that the Wethersfield Board of Ed approve the deletion of child care skills and early childhood development and replace it with the new course, early childhood development.
Okay. Is there a second? Any discussion? Okay. All right. Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? So that motion was passed. So Ellie, this is like 6A1. And Diane, would you read the next one under that?
Right. Move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the deletion of home fashions and replace with the new course costume and design.
Second.
Good. A second. Is there any discussion? I have to say, if you read the quick blurb on it too. Go ahead, Diane.
I'd just like to say something. This, at Student Programs and Services, we had a rather lengthy discussion with the staff of this division, I guess, within the high school. It was very interesting, and I can report more on it later, but it seems relevant now. But a lot of these courses are really geared towards, in the coming motions, giving these kids skills that they're going to use to be able to determine what they want to be, what they want to study when they go to college, those types of things. And this one particularly was really interesting in the fact that they saw a falling off of the home fashions, because you can do it all on Pinterest now. But a lot of kids have come forward and been interested in this costume and design, working with the school plays, working with all sorts of different activities. And the teacher that's involved, I think she's new, brings a lot of this background to it. So it's pretty exciting that I'm dying to see what comes out of that class.
Okay, so did we get a second on that motion? Okay, is there any other discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? And that motion passes. We'll move on to John Morse. Would you read the third recommended motion?
Move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the new course, Individual and Family Development.
Okay, thank you. Is there any discussion, Diane?
We also discussed in our meeting, this is hopefully going to have a UConn, is it ECE?
Yes.
I always get confused with ECL, ECE, ECS, component. So the kids will take this and be able to get college credit for this. I think this is really valuable because most kids that are going into teaching, social work, nursing, physical, all those types of healthcare fields are going to have to take an individual and family development course in their mm-hmm. college career. Mm-hmm. So I think that this, once we get the approval from UConn, which we're working through right now, will be a valuable asset for the kids.
Any other discussion? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? And that motion passes. John, moving on to the fourth one.
Move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the deletion of pre-engineering foundation of technology and design engineering and replace with the new course engineering foundations.
Second?
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Okay, let's keep going. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? That motion passes. John Cassio, would you read number 5?
With pleasure. Move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the deletion of advanced design engineering and replace with the new course manufacturing and production.
Cool. Second.
Okay, any discussion on this? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? That motion passes. John, the next one?
Move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the deletion of digital photography 1 and replace with new course digital imaging.
Cool. Second.
Is there any discussion? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? That motion passes. So we're on to number 7. Matthew?
I move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the deletion of Photography 2 and replace it with a new course, Advanced Digital Imaging.
Second.
All right. Any discussion? Digital. We're very digital here. Very good. Any discussion? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? And that motion passes. Matthew, number 8.
I move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the deletion of Architectural Drawing 1A and replace it with a new course, Architectural Engineering 1.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? That motion passes. Polly, we're on to number 9. Would you read that one?
Move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approved the deletion of Architectural Drawing 1B and replace with the new course Architectural Engineering 2.
Okay. Any discussion?
Who gets that one?
John. John. Who'd you hear first?
It's a tie.
Okay.
You can put in the records of the tie.
Okay.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? That motion passes. Polly, continue.
Move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the deletion of Transportation and Automotive Technology and replace with the new course Transportation and Alternative Energy.
Second.
Any discussion? I have to tell you, I was fascinated with the summary of that one. That was awesome. Absolutely awesome. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? That motion passes. Kevin, can I ask you to read number 11?
Yes, move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the deletion of Video Productions 1A and Video Productions 1B and replace with the new course Video Production.
Cool. Any discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? That motion passes. Kevin, the next one too?
Move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the deletion of Communication and Technology 1A and Communication and Technology 1B and replace with the new course Multimedia Communications.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? That motion passes. Just a few more. All right. Janet, number 13, please.
Move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the deletion of course Transportation Engineering.
Second.
Any discussion? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? And that motion passes. And Janet, number 14.
Move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the deletion of course Construction Management.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? And that motion passes. Just a quick comment as we move on. You know, we have a 21st century building in that Wethersfield High School, and now we're putting in 21st century curriculum. Fabulous place. Okay, we're moving on to action item 6B. Polly?
Move that the Wethersfield Board of Education approve the operating budget for the 2017 2018 school year is presented by the administration in the amount of $58,277,882.
Second. Okay. Is there any discussion? That was good. Any discussion? Any more discussion? Matthew.
I'm certainly happy to support a budget which does not, reduce the amount of programs and that we provide for our children. I mean, the advancement that we've made over the last few years of reducing class size and expanding and changing curriculum is great, and I certainly don't want to go backwards. I do believe, and I think that if you served, over a long enough time, that you see that the public does react to different things that are going on. And it's something that, government is generally, when you see the population come, then you have to react accordingly. So I'm curious to the superintendent, what would a club cost for this particular board?
For lacrosse. For the lacrosse, yeah. It's largely going to depend on how far we go with it. So, for example, what we were looking at today, and again, this is based upon the projection of numbers, whether or not you have one club team that's co-ed or two club teams, we're looking at a stipend of $2,500 per coach.
Okay. So if we had a club team for boys and girls, and I don't think you should do one or the other, what would that be?
Well, it's in terms of the club for both boys, it's $2,500 each.
So $5,000 to get a boys and girls club team off the ground at Wethersfield High School, put a W on their chest, and have us start the process.
Yeah. And there are other ancillary costs as well. We talked about uniforms. We talked about transportation. We talked about equipment. We talked about the potential of looking for grants. And what we're looking to do is be able to utilize athletic escrow funds coupled with pay-to-play to get this off the ground. Again, this won't be a full-time program. You're looking at club for 2 years, but we think we can make it work.
You think you can make, help me understand that, you think you can make it work within our current budget?
Yes.
Or would they need additional funds from us? There's been a lot of discussion. I'm just trying to understand the clarification there.
With the help of the parents, we can make this work, leaving our budget where it is.
In our current budget. And is that the anticipation?
Our anticipation for next year's budget is at 2.94%. We can make it work. I'm going to be very clear with you in helping everyone understand, because members of the public need to hear this clearly also. Yeah. Please remember that the 2.94% budget maintains our programs as they are, maintains our staff. If we get into the issue where we are having to make drastic reductions, I only have so many materials I can cut. You can only cut so many reams of paper and so many pencils.
Yeah, sure.
It ends up being people and programs. So I want to be clear in helping people understand, while I support the lacrosse program and getting this up and running, I also have to be cognizant of the fact if we get hit with a zero budget increase, that's going to be people and programs.
Oh, for sure.
And I don't say this to try and create angst or anxiety. I just have to say it from the perspective of it being a reality. The other aspect right now, in terms of moving forward and bringing this budget before you this evening, is the fact that you've got the governor's budget. We don't know exactly what's going to become of this governor's budget. Right now, the governor's budget proposes $2.8 million of municipal exposure for the teacher's retirement fund. In addition to that, we have the special education fund that's newly created. Wethersfield is in line to get $4.728 million. You also couple that with the idea here that Wethersfield is one of, I believe, 31 municipalities that actually sees an increase in ECS dollars. So we'll have to see how that plays out. So in terms of potentially starting this lacrosse program, I think our meeting today worked out quite nicely, where we're talking about doing it together. You know, the piece with the DECA, and I do want to just go back to this year's budget, that's one of those difficult things where you're getting toward the end of the fiscal year, and we've narrowed the gap with regard to our budget deficit, but we're not there yet. So we have to be cautious and kind of hold out and wait. So for next year, in terms of the 2.94, where we are, that maintains all of our programs. With the support of the parents, with the pay to play, we think we can get the club off the ground.
I'm all set for right now.
Okay, John.
Go ahead, John.
A couple questions.
For us to have lacrosse as part of our budget, do we not have to include it in our budget so that it has a line item and an account assigned to it, whether or not it ends up getting cut later on when the council does whatever great stuff they're going to do to us? I understand that, but mm-hmm. if we're to have a program, even as a club, does we not need to include it in the budget?
No, in this case, we'd be utilizing the pay-to-play dollars to support that. And we'd be using, we don't usually parse out by one each individual athletic program. We have an athletic budget. So we're not looking at tapping into the athletic budget. We're looking at using escrow at this point in time. So that's money that comes in from ticket sales, and we offset it that way.
Okay. Second question, when is the DECA trip? When is the last date that we would have to either fund that or make a decision about it?
I understand that the DECA states are, you guys can tell me better.
2 weeks.
March 13th. So we don't know. Right now, we don't know how many are going. Okay, so we're kind of up in the air on that, so we'll need to see that. So March 13th, so we'll need to know after that. And again, I mentioned earlier, if we can get the MBR situation rectified, I think that's going to provide us with a little bit of flexibility.
The March 13th date, that's for the state one?
States, yep.
But the money they're talking about is for the national, the one in San Francisco?
Correct.
When is the date that we need to have a decision on that?
Well, we're going to need to know what happens with the state. That's going to give us an indication of how many are going.
So if they don't make it, we don't,
it's a moot
issue.
Well,
if they do make it,
true.
Then what's our time? I'm trying to understand, you know, if someone needs to fundraise, do they have any time or is it really already expired?
No. I think it's at the point where it's expired. So we're going to need to get this MBR situation squared away.
That would make our life a lot easier.
Mm-hmm.
It's
would.
Been lingering for too long.
Sure
a little
has.
Bit too long. Anyone else with comments? Diane?
I just want to understand this lacrosse thing. We are not making an appropriation through next year's budget for the lacrosse program. It is going to be a direct pay for play
yep.
through the escrow thing.
Yes.
And we're not committing to $50,000.
We are not.
We would only be committing to approximately $5,000.
Correct.
Okay. And I don't have any problems supporting this budget. I think it's a responsible budget, given that probably 90% of it is contractual based. And there are no new programs or initiatives. We're not able to fund any programs or initiatives. But I would caution the public tonight that this isn't a done deal. This still has to go through the board, and this still has to the council. But this still all hinges on the state budget, which today the Office of Fiscal Analysis came out and estimated a $65 million deficit for the state of Connecticut. That money has to come from somewhere, and unfortunately, more times than not, it comes from municipalities and boards of education, funding for that. It's going to even be dire if there's no concessions reached with state employee unions, which means that people are going to lose their jobs, but then we're going to have to take more money away from the towns and boards of education. So it all hinges on what the legislature's budget comes out with sometime in June, Kevin. So we're going to keep our fingers crossed till then. But I, too, voice the concerns of the superintendent that as much as all of us would like to fund an athletic program or any program with kids that teaches kids teamwork through the school system, the fact that, you know, we can't fund these special ed teachers, these ESL teachers, these math tutors is of great concern to me. And, you know, the educational component right now has to take priority with our limited resources. And if we could work with a way, as you suggested today, to try to get this program going, that's good. But I can't, you know, the money just isn't there for stuff. So I'd like to see a preschool program, too. But So I will support this budget.
John?
Thank you, Bobby. I can support this budget because it's not the final time we're going to look at it. So having said that,
I mean, they're giving us more.
This probably will meet with us once again after the town council gives us their timeline and the information that we're waiting for from them. More importantly, I'm excited to hear that the lacrosse program is starting off as a club at the high school, and there's a way to get going through it, similar to what we did with the boys volleyball at the Wethersfield High School, exactly the same thing. So anything new that's coming in, we're following a process of what we did years ago with the volleyball at the mm-hmm. high school. Now we're doing it with the lacrosse team. So at least we're following the same road and not doing something any different. So mm-hmm. that's a good thing. I'm a little distressed about the $4,000 for the DECA program. And I would really I know we're going to have finalists. I can just tell you that now. I'm going to be positive. After the March 13th event at the AquaTurf, several of our students, not maybe all of them, will be finalists and head out to San Francisco. That's my wish for all of you. So I would like to get a timeline from that through you, Mr. Moore, or through the teacher, as to what it is exactly when these students have to be prepared to get their flights, to get the money up front, because the kids already have their money. It's the district that doesn't. So I think that that's something that we all have to work towards. And I would like this to be a priority if the MBR funds are given to us, because as it said, they were only told 4 days ago. And that's really not the way I would want to be treated if I was a student at the high school at this point. So I'm in full support of giving that $4,000 to the DECA program, and I would make that a priority. And if something like this happens again next year, we need to let them know, like in September, so they can start working on fundraising of some kind. Right now, a little too late to move in that direction. So having said that, I would wholeheartedly hope this board would support that $4,000 to DECA as soon as possible, and we can get a timeline of when this whole situation needs to go at that point. So that's where I'm on with mm-hmm. this budget. I'm more than happy to support it, but I really want to make sure that we don't put anyone in the situation we're putting them in now.
Okay, Diane?
I'm sorry, I was going to wait to talk about the DECA thing till after, because this was a motion about the budget, but since we're talking about it, I would also support, I agree with John about this DECA thing. I have had the opportunity to see a lot of kids that I know go through this program and go off to nationals and represent Wethersfield, and they've done some great things. In fact, John, your daughter was involved at DECA.
And I did it 3 years ago, went to Orlando.
Yeah, and some of my kids' closest friends went through it, and they all spoke about what a valuable experience it was. And I was quite taken that the kids in DECA came and all spoke about that program. That's part of what the program teaches them, the ability to come up and speak and give thoughtful presentations. So if we can possibly shake that money loose from the town council, and I would suggest you all go to the town council mm-hmm. meeting on Monday and reinforce that, we can hopefully fund as much as we can from it for it. But our hands are kind of tied right now with that money being tied up with the council. So I would suggest you all bring your presentations and what you spoke about tonight and come to the town council meeting on Monday night and tell them the exact same thing you told us tonight.
Janet?
And I was glad to see one of my former Brownies here tonight.
Janet.
So I commend all these children that came out to speak, and it's not an easy thing to do, whether it was for lacrosse, whether it was for for DECA. I know Justin got a little nervous there, but you did great.
Thank you.
I am passionate about DECA because I wasn't in DECA, I was in VICA, which is now called Skills USA. And knowing what it did for me at almost 48, I still rave about the program. And as many of the board members know, and Sally, it's a program that it just does an enormous for any student, much less an adult. So I really would like to see that the town council approved, give us this budget to let you students go. And again, like everyone else has echoed, the timeline, it really does stink, and it's really not fair to you. And I know how passionate you are, because I'm a former student that was in one of these programs, and I was very passionate about it. I wasn't fortunate to go to nationals. I was fortunate to go to states, and it was a great experience. And you're absolutely right. You do get to keep connections with children from all walks of life. And when you're there at DECA, you're all DECA students. You're not a DECA student that lives in Greenwich, and you're not a DECA student that lives in Hartford. You're, you know, all part of the same organization, and it doesn't matter what financial means you have in your life. You're all equal. So it's a passionate program, and I really would like to see as many of the students go. So like Diane has mentioned, definitely go to your town council meeting and show them the projects that you've, you know, put together. And I think that they could appreciate all your hard work.
Anyone else? Kevin, on the budget?
Yes, thank you. I just kind of want to reiterate what John and Diane were talking about. This is obviously a responsible budget. 98% of it is contractual. But to go back to Diane's point about, it's to this point, it's being pushed over to the town council. So if we're talking about DECA funding, you show up their next meeting and say, hey, we need our minimum budget requirement dollars to be allocated to the board. And if we're talking about lacrosse, we're finding some creative ways to fund it via escrow and pay to play, and we think there is a solution there. However, if the town council, you know, does not deem that this budget is appropriate and decreases our funding, I mean, it's going to be near impossible to start any new programs. I mean, there's really nothing left to cut to this point. The next thing to go is people, and that's something we desperately do not want to do. So I wish all the lacrosse people, all the lacrosse students and parents, we're still here. We'll obviously get the message out to them and to all the DECA students that if you could show up to the town council and deliver the same message that you properly and I gave here tonight, that would be terrific.
Great. Matthew?
Just for clarity, the DECA is not affected by the motion of the 2017-18 budget.
No.
That's separate. We can talk about that under like unfinished business or something like that, I think.
Yeah, John brought it up, so.
Right. it's way to go, Diane.
They brought it up. That's out of the room.
All right, so I'll leave the DECA conversation to unfinished business.
He did.
And in the operating, but is DECA in the operating budget for 2017-18? We should probably have that conversation.
Yes, it is.
Because that's actually pertinent.
Yes, it is.
All right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Got it. So we'll talk about DECA 9.
Okay. Any other discussion? Okay. For our budget, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? The motion passes. Thank you, everyone. Okay, next we're going to move on to our Board of Ed meetings held. The first one on the list is CREC, which was February 15th that I attended. It's at the CREC headquarters in Hartford. CREC is our Capital Region Education Council, and Wethersfield's one of the 35 towns that makes up the council. Interesting, the meeting had a typical agenda, but the council quickly moved to a lengthy discussion on the challenges each town faces with their education budgets. Many towns are faced with the same issues as Wethersfield, actually makes you feel better, and no one knows at this time what the state budget impact will be. But we did get some good advice, best advice so far, I thought, other than our internal administration put forth by the CREC chair, was that at this time, all town board of eds continue to develop their budgets, and all need to do so thinking about the best interest of the kids in their town. So it was very interesting. They just completely let the agenda go, and budget discussions continued in this meeting until adjournment. We also have policy and planning. Polly?
We met on the 15th of February, and we re-looked at the 4000 series. We had some changes. And those have been sent back to CABE. They have not They haven't gotten us all of the updated material, so that's still ongoing. We hope to bring that to you for final approval shortly.
Okay, thank you. Student Program and Services Committee, a little bit of work done in that group. Can you give us a brief summary?
Are you trying to rein me in?
Never.
I spoke during, after Sally's presentation and during the motions. So that pretty much summarizes what most of the meeting was. It was, I thought, a very fruitful discussion. Also, in addition to that meeting, we had discussions about the AP exams. The committee had requested a survey of AP students because we were seeing some courses, very low numbers of kids taking the AP exams. So there was a pre-survey done with the kids, and we reviewed what the post-survey was going to be to take a look at, you know, with our resources being so tight, looking at how valuable some or certain AP classes are in comparison to the UConn EC and so on. So once we find out, the kids, I think, take the AP exam the beginning of May. I should know that. So once they sign up and take those exams, then we'll, Mr. Moore is going to, and his staff is going to survey those kids to see what the results are. And that will, I think, help for further planning at the high school level as well as in the curriculum committee. We also had a brief discussion about the capstone projects, and I think we're going to continue that and put that on our next agenda and have some more discussions in it. And you know, the one thing that came through tonight is Monique's presentation to me is a perfect example of what a capstone would be. I think you and the kids that are working with you, it's a valuable experience that they're going to be able to take forward. And even some of the projects that the DECA kids are working on are part of that whole concept of a capstone project. So.
Okay, thank you, Diane. School Projects and Building Committee, Mr. Emmett.
Thank you, Mrs. Granato. Last evening there was a building committee meeting. Mr. Moore and Mr. Raffinello attended that meeting on my behalf, and I'm pleased to report that the building committee approved the purchase of the music equipment that went into the recording studio, so that's all taken care of. At this point in time, there is no further action on the roof screening. I know that's still a item that's up in the air. Mr. Moore reiterated our desire to finish off this project with the purchase of the $154,300 for the remaining technology as part of the project. So that was reiterated again last evening.
Okay, thank you. And John, we have our Memorial Day Parade Committee.
Thank you. Yep, we met last night. It's Saturday. The parade is Saturday, May 27th, in bright sunshine at the Motor Vehicle Department. Lineup is at between 8 and 9, and walk starts at 9. From there, if it rains, we're going to go to the high school.
Got a spot.
March around.
We're going to march around the halls, up and down the stairs, the halls. And then we're going to see how many people fit in the elevator and see where we go with that. But they are seeking ideas for a theme as well as speaker and parade marshals. We will have the presence of our band and cheerleaders and dance team, as well as the fife and drum, as well as invitations have gone out to other bands and marching people. So we're good.
Okay, thank you, John. Meetings that are scheduled to be held.
Pardon me, Madam Chair. I just had one thing to report. The Finance and Information Committee met tonight. We had one item on the agenda, and that was the continuing issue of the MBR. And at this point, we will the council or the budget committee for the council intends to or has told us anyway that they will put this on their agenda. Hopefully they will vote on the issue on Monday, and we will have a letter from the town next week, and we'll have the opportunity to review it and present it at the next meeting. So just so you're, stay tuned.
Thank you. Okay, meetings scheduled. Policy and planning tomorrow night at 5:30. WEC, Wethersfield Early Childhood Collaborative, on Monday, the 13th of March. School Projects Building Committee on March 13th at 6:30. And Finance and Information Management Committee meeting on March 14th at 5:30. Is there any unfinished business? Matthew?
I'd like to add a discussion of DECA to unfinished business.
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Okay.
Mike, can I just get a clarification on the timing? I know it hurt some dates, but I guess I admittedly just wasn't clear. We have a state DECA tournaments coming up in March something?
13th.
March 13th. Two weeks from now. And at that point, most likely, considering our track record, we'll have some people that will be attending this mm-hmm. national. When's national?
End of April.
And we've had some some students that have fundraised and gotten their aspect together as far as going to nationals if some of them expect to go. Is that generally true? So, board, as I see this, an MBE does not solve, will not make a difference in my particular vote about whether or not we want to essentially lift for this very narrow purpose our spending freeze for the ability for the students to go to DECA. I also don't think, even if we have 16 kids that make it to nationals, that's $2,000, not even the full four. $2,000 is not going to balance our $60 million budget at the end of the year. If we are in that much trouble and we're $2,000 short, we're going to be going to other sources in order to figure out our fiscal situation. So instead of, I don't think NBE doesn't change my opinion. Instead of keeping the students, the teachers, and everybody in limbo for something that they have worked hard, it's not just worked hard for, but planned for financially and otherwise, I would recommend that this board lift the spending freeze, not the whole thing, just for specifically to allow for the DECA funds to be transferred over. I think it will resolve the problem. I don't think it changes our outlook on this particular year's budget. It's so de minimis that it really doesn't change anything. So I'll make the motion to lift the spending freeze specifically for the purpose of DECA in order to allow up to, I think it's $4,000. We may not even use that much. To allow us to release the bond, that would be my motion, to lift the spending freeze up to $4,000 for the DECA chaperone.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? I'd like to say something. I know that, the freeze was put into effect, and the freeze is written up that it's non-essential items. Well, that does not mean pencils and paper anymore. Non-essential items, and I stated this today, can be a light bulb for a smart board. Now, if you're in an elementary classroom and your smart board bulb goes out, you have no curriculum going at the moment because that is one of your major sources of getting the curriculum to your children. My problem with this motion that Matt has brought up, and I have no problem with finding $4,000 for them, but my problem is, lifting this freeze, there's these other non-essential, and I'm making fun of that term now, non-essential items that are out there that are also very important. And on top of that, I do want this MBR money. I want it. It will help our budget deficit. The money is ours. And I do think that pressure has to be put on that we get this money. Not that we alleviate the problem by lifting it for one group. And I do believe that if we lift it for one group, we have to lift it for all. And that's how I look at it. It has nothing against DECA. I'm going to say, I read Justin's. He gave it to me, and I'm in awe. I couldn't have written it. It was beautifully done, intriguing. You have a future. But if that's a sample of it, I mean, I am completely in awe. Is it a capstone-like project? Yes. But my problem with this is if we lift it for this, we really should lift it for it all. And that's why, has nothing against DECA, but that's my point on that. I would like that MBR money. Anyone else? Diane?
We have another team that's going to national, the Jets team, right?
Mm-hmm.
Are they in the same predicament, Mike?
We haven't heard from them.
We have not. I don't believe that they are. That's typically not something that we're funding, but I can check on that for you.
We don't fund a chaperone for that?
I don't believe so.
So who goes with them?
Let me check and see.
Okay. I thought
I think you're going.
Yeah, I'll check on that for you, Diane.
Watch out for those flying turkeys.
Where are they going?
Are you going with them, Diane?
I'd go with DECA if I could.
I believe that Jets, they won money at their competition last year, and that goes into their fund.
Oh, okay. Oh, so they get some money for winning. Okay.
Thank
okay.
you. Thank you.
And I have to say, I agree with Bobby. And believe me, if we could find this money, I think we should move heaven and earth to do that. But we set a dangerous precedent lifting for one specific group. I think that we need to put pressure on the town council to release that, as Bobby said and I said earlier, to release that money so we can fund these things that we have some commitments for. It's, you know, it's only fair. And I feel terrible. These kids just found out 4 days ago that they can't do this. But if we could get some pressure to put on the council to release these funds so we can, you know, send our kids to San Francisco.
If this worked at an expedient pace, we could know by Monday night whether this works. I don't know if we can do this, Justin. I know. Any other comments? John?
You know, I understand their arguments, but I do agree with Matt. It's really very unfair to tell kids who spend all year working on something that 4 days beforehand that they're not going to be able to go for the national competition. My daughter went 3 years ago. It was a great experience. It's the timing of it. It's the shortness of that notice that has wounded my sense of fairness for these kids. And while I understand that, you know, you do it for one, you do it for all, that doesn't apply when people know 4 days ago. That really is just, that's wrong. If we can't do this, then we're not doing anything for our kids. And if we can't do this, you know, you come and see me, I'll give you a donation to help you go to San Francisco because it is that important. You should be able to do it. We shouldn't leave you hanging at this last moment. That is unfair.
And nobody's going to disagree, you know, with that.
I know. It's, you know,
this
sometimes
is hard.
It's not going to make a difference to us whether our deficit is 118 or 122,000. It isn't going to make that much of a difference. Matt is right.
Mm. But I think it's if we do for one, then we do for all. That's my opinion on this. Any other discussion? We need to hear from anyone else here? Janet? No?
No.
Okay. So let's make a... Let's have all in favor of this motion.
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Aye. Any abstentions?
Wait a minute.
Yeah. Who said what?
Aye.
That was a quick vote.
I think I do a roll call.
Move for a roll call.
Okay.
All right. Oh,
Matt, would you read? Say your motion. We'll start with that.
Well, I mean, if it was helpful. The motion is to lift the spending freeze for the purpose of allowing of appropriating funds for DECA chaperones up to $4,000. That's my motion.
Okay, we've had our discussion.
Okay, I'll roll call.
Okay.
Mr. Cascio.
Yes.
Mrs. Fitzpatrick.
Reluctantly nay.
Mr. Forrest.
Yes.
Mr. Hill.
No.
Ms. Moon.
No.
Mrs. Vazel.
With my heart breaking, I'm sorry, no.
Mr. Morris.
Yes.
Mrs. Granato.
No. Any abstentions? Nobody? Okay. That was hard.
Yeah, so it's 5-3.
Okay. Any other yes. unfinished business? Okay, so John, go ahead.
If we hear,
on from the town council on Monday. Will they tell us, congratulations, you just won?
No.
Are we going to get the money? How long will it take? That's the difficulty.
They'd have to have a resolution.
So we could, it could possibly be May.
No, John, if the MBR is passed by the town council, we can, and I'm looking at Matt Kazaka, if he's back there hiding, we can basically start lifting this spending freeze. That's what we would do.
But they would have to pass a resolution. So a resolution would have to be on their agenda for Monday night. If it's not on their agenda for Monday night, it would have to be on their agenda for their next meeting, their second meeting in March. I think that's what John's getting at.
And then we'd have to pass it, too.
Mm-hmm. No, we don't have to.
No, we can lift the spending freeze.
We don't have to.
We do have to agree to that solution and provide that information to the state so that it meets the minimum
budget requirement. On the MBR.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But and I think the piece here. If they do what they have to do to say, we're going to release that money, I mean, just, mm-hmm. you know, it's just a formality for us to accept the money, sure. but. Yeah. Still, we would know, and you'd be able to move forward with funding that.
Mm-hmm.
I might suggest that if that goes through and we get that information from the town, that we just schedule a brief special board meeting to take a vote on it, and then I would send that information up to the state. That would meet the state's requirement for, you know, having the agreement on the resolution or on the solution, and then we'd be whole with MBR and wouldn't face any fines.
So the key that we have to see is if the council will have a resolution drafted and placed on their agenda for Monday night.
Maybe if they're listening to us, they might want to put it on your agenda for Monday night.
Maybe you're all watching the State of the Union.
That's true.
But I think it's imperative that they have that resolution on their agenda because they can choose, I mean, if anything, it's a placeholder, so they can have the discussion and vote on it if they need to. But if they don't have it on their agenda, they won't be able to vote on it. I mean, if they choose to table it till the next meeting, that's one thing. But I think we need to have them put it on their agenda.
We're on unfinished business. Anybody else?
I just wanted to, as far as the action of the council next week, we were given the impression that this would be dealt with next week and we would hear from them. So I think that, and the idea of maybe having a special meeting would be, that if that can be worked out, that is going to give us a lot of, it'll give us much more breathing room on our budget. And I agree, I think there is something as important as the DECA, and I'm sorry that I had to vote against that motion, because I have, in the time that I've been here, I've seen some of the presentations that this club has made, and it's absolutely fantastic. So I think that, and I think we all agree that once the MBR issue is settled, there are going to be a lot of things that we can address that right at this particular point, even a couple of $1,000 can make a big difference. So I hope that you guys can be patient and bear with us on this and understand that we're really doing the best we can here for you, for everybody. So. That was my only
John?
Comment.
Thank you, Bobby. I truly believe and hope that this item is on their agenda because we've been told so many stories. We've been told this in December, January, and now we're really getting into March. So it's almost like the groundhog saw a shadow and the town isn't allowing us to fund our budget properly. So I think at this point, I don't know. I know you have such a good working relationship with Jeff, Mike. Maybe you can have him make sure he can put that on the agenda. We can suggest something to him, which might be a good idea.
Mr. Cassio, it was my understanding today, based upon our meeting, that that was the intention that was going to take
place. I understand that, Mike.
He would be formulating a proposed solution.
Good. But we've been told that for quite some time now. Every time there's a solution. So just want to make sure we know what we're doing.
Madam Chair, would it be appropriate for me to make a motion right now? I'd like to move that the Wethersfield Board of Education request through the chair that the town council, the mayor, be directed to respectfully place something on the agenda to take action on this.
Second.
Because of the nature. Oh, hang on.
I'm sorry.
Premature.
Because of the timing and the critical nature of this, specifically, you know, for these kids.
Mm-hmm. Is there a second?
Second.
You know, in discussion on this is why we sat down today, to tell them how important this is, and to say that we're kind of in a stall situation with our budget, and it's not fair. Not fair to DECA, it's not fair to other organizations that are running, it's not fair to really many of the programs, field trips. As I've said before, we always think it's pencils and papers. It's much more important than that. That's being held up. So I agree with you, Diane. That's the route I would like to go, because that's our money. And we've been told many times, John, that we have this money coming to us, and we have yet to see it. I agree. Any other discussion?
Well, I think there's a motion on the table, right? And then was there a second?
There's a second.
Yes, and we're on discussion.
This motion that you just made?
Yes. Matthew?
So is it my understanding, Ms. Fitzpatrick, that I guess we can't direct the town council, but to request the town council to put the MBR funding decision on their next agenda? Is that
respectfully request.
Respectfully request, right?
advise them of the dire timing situation because of, what these kids are facing.
I will say again, that was said today.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I'm in support of that, and as we go around, even with this motion, maybe through dialogue, we could have a bit of a quick straw poll. Is if I were to adjust that previous motion that I made, that made it in the alternative, because it sounds like this MBR money is sort of a sticky wicket to then sort of allowing DECA to go forward. Instead of coming forward with having a special meeting to rediscuss exactly all this we discussed. After this motion comes forward, I could make a motion that says, sort of like in the alternative, if the town council approves the MBR solution as we've discussed, we would direct the superintendent to release the spending freeze specifically for
that. I think you need to post that, and I think that has to be a special meeting. I don't think we can, in anticipation, do that. I think that
we're in a regular meeting.
I know, but for something like that, I think that the state is going to require that it be done in a certain fashion after the resolution is passed by the town. And maybe Matt can speak to that, but there are certain standards that you have to meet through the state for these things. So I wouldn't have any. I mean, we could find out Monday night, and Tuesday night we can all get together at
Bobby's
your house.
Your house.
Yeah. Oh. Stillman, please.
My thing's recording my thing here. Hang on. I think that if we do this, if we can, as soon as we find out, we have a special meeting and it'll take all of 2 minutes to get that through. Yep. But I don't think for something like this, I don't think we can do something in anticipation of that.
Can I just
Holly?
Also follow up? I do believe that once council has approved a resolution and they have notified the board that this is the resolution, and then it comes back to the board for approval, but then I believe you, because the letter was addressed to you,
correct,
will have to notify the state and say this is how we anticipate handling this, and we do need state approval on this, don't
we? And that would be a phone call the following morning to Captain Chambers and Kathy Dempsey.
All right, so we don't have to, have too much of a...
By a hand-delivered letter. Yeah, absolutely. Right. We've been in contact with the state with regard to this process. Remember, we got the letter in September, on September 30th. We've been going back and forth on this. And, you know, the other thing to remember, I want to just go back, and then I know there's a motion here, but the idea of the timing on this, part of the problem with the timing on this is we didn't know about this situation back in September. The budget freeze came about when we had an additional reduction in the ECS money, which occurred on December 29th. When we came back from the holiday break, that's when we had to enact the budget freeze. We're looking for the MBR money to be able to provide us with some relief and close the gap. In addition to that, we're looking at not funding maintenance and not funding technology purchases. I will have for the full board an accounting of, you know, what that's going to end up costing. So it is one of these difficult situations. We'd certainly like to get it resolved. It's been hanging out there for a while.
Could I also follow up,
Holly?
On that? I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I think also needs to be made clear is that we have that even with the $88,000 that is due us from the town, this is not going to solve our issue. We're still going to be looking at maintenance cuts.
Correct.
Or should I say maintenance freeze, mm-hmm. For till the end of the year. Also technology adjustments, as it were. Keith is looking right now to see where there are areas that he can basically do without. The other thing is even on textbooks and supplies, we're looking at this. So this is not a situation where this is going to be a be-all and end-all. What that does is it basically reduces the deficit that we have. And so I think that's really important for people to understand, is that once that funding comes through, that's not going to solve all of our problems. Mm-hmm. We're still going to be showing at that time a deficit, mm-hmm. that could obviously change between now and the end of the year. Mm-hmm. But I think that's really important to understand. And this whole issue is, you know, will be completely changed next year anyway. So. But I do just want to follow up on that particular point. So, yes, this would be really great if we could be absolutely sure that if we hear on Monday night, that Tuesday morning, we can call the state and then we can say, okay, great, we're going to fund, because we don't really know that that's going to be the case. So I just want to be, that doesn't make it less of a priority, but I think it's also important for board members to understand, and the public to understand that.
Okay, any other discussion on Diane's motion?
I'm happy to support the motion, and I do want to caution you that if you think the council is going to solve this on Monday, we have a long history now of fundance avoidance, and that is unlikely, in my opinion, to happen. I hope it does, but
why all these kids got to come Monday night.
I know. It's why you have to go and tell council. This is some of the consequences that comes out of us getting a 0.4 last year. This has played out very badly so far for this board this year, and these are the consequences of those kinds of decisions about cutting funding. It sounds great to say reduce your taxes, but these are the kind of people that get hurt when we do that. Those are the choices. I think we have to find a way to make that work, and if that requires contributions or more fundraising, I would encourage you to do that anyway and not plan on council. We can hope for it, but have plan B, because I think you're probably going to need to have plan B.
I know.
Sorry.
Yeah. She's ready to bust up there. I know. Any other comments? Come sit up here.
Send me a text.
You get paid a lot for these.
Any other discussion on Diane's motion? Okay, Diane, would you re-say your motion?
She forgot.
Respectfully submitted, I know, is part of it.
And the court reporter read it back.
Take action on place on their agenda.
Oh, let me try it again. That the Wethersfield Board of Education, through its chairman, respectfully requests that the town council place a resolution on their agenda to address the issue of the MBR funding.
For
Monday night.
March 6th.
Whatever.
March 6th, 2017.
Good, we're there.
Yeah, I get that. Okay.
And for those of that don't know what MBR, it's minimum.
Oh, yeah, yes.
Minimum budget required.
And you'll have to do that like tomorrow because the agenda packets, like, if they still go on Thursdays, I think. So.
We need a second, I think.
Second, okay. All right. Any other discussion on this? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, that motion passes. Any other unfinished business? Okay. So is there anyone out there wishing to make a public comment? Please come on up to the podium and state your name and address. And may I remind you that there is a 5-minute limit.
You're on.
Oh, go on, dude. Go ahead.
Donna Messenger, 87 Clovercrest. I almost really hate to be here and having this discussion, but I came here because I felt like I absolutely had to. The superintendent mentioned adding an ELL tutor or ELL teacher last meeting, and I want you to explain that I think you need an ELL teacher, but not for the reasons that Mr. Emmett said, that you only have two ELL teachers for 3,000 or students. In my experience, having my daughter go through the program, that's not the whole problem at all. The tutors were fine. They were exceptional sometimes. There was adequate ratios. The ELL teacher, my daughter was in sixth grade for 6 weeks, seventh grade and eighth grade. And the ELL teacher never taught her. So she had three different ELL tutors that were great. She tested out in a year and a half, and basically at the end of that eighth grade, she was out of the program. But the problem with the ELL program is when the child exits, because when you give the test, it's a standardized test called Last Links. You get a 4 or 5, you're out of the program. But when I looked at, I couldn't understand that she's not going to get any more instructions, and I was so afraid she was going into high school, because I knew the level she was at, because I'm always helping her. I'm involved with everything. So, I'm thinking she's still at a fifth grade level, and she's done excellent work. She's worked hard, but 2 years, you can't expect everything, right? So she's exited out of the program and there's no more help. So I searched for something. I put her in Read 180. I had to get special permission. And that Read 180 did nothing. The ELL tutor raised her Lex style 370 points in 1 year. The Read 180 raised her Lexile 0. It actually dipped. And I kept asking, by the middle of the year, I'm like, something's wrong here. And it turns out the program isn't customized, isn't, directed to her needs. So I propose that you hire an ELL teacher, but for kids that have exited, that are just left stranded at a way below grade level, and nobody's looking out. Mrs. Burlow, basically said, I only have to do a 4 or 5 and she's out of the program. The high school does nothing. So, my daughter is amazing. She has gotten high honors. I don't know how this happens. When you get a Lextile of 100 and 300 and 600, and now after summer school, now it's 800. But she's gotten high honors, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th. but she's still writing and reading basically at a fifth grade level. And I'm asking for help from the high school, and there's no help. So I would like to propose an ELL teacher that really monitors those kids. And especially at the high school level, it's so important, because if you start, you know, at middle school or high school, you have a very limited time to catch up. She wants to go to college, and I think she's capable. I think she could be an honor student. She lost 2 years. Now she's in 10th grade, and her lexile almost didn't budge. Now, I know what she needs. She needs basic fifth grade, sixth grade grammar. And I've been begging for it, and I can't get the principal to budge for a tutor something, you know, that would work.
You have one more minute.
And so I really think that, yes, I think you should have an EL teacher, but you should really understand the program. I know I've talked to one board member who was really helpful. She directed me to Superintendent Emmett. He said he was going to work on it. I haven't heard from him yet. I'm hoping that he is going to help me with my daughter. But I also want to educate you so you can review everything with the ELL program and think about, you know, what's really going on. Support services. So a child goes through the program and they get one class, you know, in lieu of like social studies in the language. So that's ELL program, and a study hall. The support services are called, but there's no support services. It's just a study hall, which, you know, it's better than nothing. I mean, a study hall, a regular study hall would have a teacher that she could go for help. This one has a tutor, you know, whatever. You know, the classes are the most important and useful thing. You know, I asked, well, you know, I can help her with the, you know, classes. You know, why don't you teach her during support services? No, we can't do that. So, you know, and monitoring services are absolutely nothing. So the only thing that really matters is that class time. So I really think you need to learn about the ELL program, not just say, oh, we'll just get another tutor or get another, because that's not going to solve the real problem that the kids in the middle and high school face. And I'm hoping that superintendent will get back to me about my daughter's situation. And I'm hoping that you guys really will think, because there's probably a lot of creative ways, you know, to improve the program that everybody's just sort of ignored. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you. Anyone else for public comment?
I just want to ask, the meeting on Monday, the town council meeting, if the MBR gets approved, we need some sort of assurance that we are going to get the funding that we need. Is there any way that we can?
How about if we stay tuned to Monday?
Okay.
All right. And then, you know, we could talk.
Okay. Thank you.
I promise you that. Anyone else with public comment? Okay. Are there any board comments?
Madam Chair.
Janet?
Quite a few comments today. I just wanted to say I can't wait to see your hunger action schedule come out and hopefully have breakfast with you and the kids. That sounds like so much fun. And kudos to you. That's a hard one to do with young kids that really don't want to eat breakfast and are picky eaters. I have one of those. And she's at the high school. I'd also like to congratulate the dance team. They placed first in the state's competition this past weekend, and third place in the POM competition. I guess this is their second time that they've ever placed in states. The last time they did was in 2013. One of the things I'd like to bring back, and I know he's not here, was
the music presentation that was presented. And I know a couple of the board members liked the presentation and the idea, but there was a few things that I had some questions about and maybe can get addressed at our next meeting. I took the privilege of going ahead and looking up some information based on what the state requires. And one of the things I had concerns about is will there be a beginning orchestra, the beginning band? Is it the requirement that the Wethersfield Public Schools curriculum currently would like to continue to do? The beginning of band is for grade 4. So an orchestra and chorus is for grades 5 and 6. The presentation was kind of hard to understand because it was not the reception, whatever. And then show the choir at, is it part of the choir program that he's trying to pilot or piloting at his school? Is it the curriculum that the Wethersfield Public School has?
Yeah, Jenna, if you could please email me all your questions, okay, and I'll be happy to respond, and I'll send that to the full board in the
okay
Friday update.
Just because I have, like, a lot, you know, having a both children that were invested in band and they enjoyed orchestra, I just want to make sure that whatever this pilot is, it's being followed by the Wethersfield Public Schools curriculum.
What if we put that on the next agenda for programs and services?
Yeah.
Maybe he can come and have
sure
a...
It's very long.
Yeah.
Either be on that one or the next one.
Yeah, I just felt like I couldn't quite understand what the whole thing was okay trying to, but I will email you the information.
Thank you.
And that's it.
John.
I just received a CABE liaison newsletter, and they're requesting boards of ed to take advantage of their upcoming professional development programs, and I'll have Ellie send this all to you. One is March 8th. It's the CABE Day on the Hill, and it's being held at the Bushnell. So I'll definitely send that to everyone so they can see what's going on there. Monique, congratulations. You did it. Good job up there. And I look forward to a report after it's done to see how it's going. So that'll be really exciting. The other news to go along with the report of how the teams are doing, the Wethersfield High School varsity cheerleaders placed 4th last weekend and for their first competition, and they will be going again this weekend coming to another second competition. And 4 of the squad members placed all conference. So they've worked very hard this season, and congratulations to the varsity girls. Thank you.
Great. Anyone else on the board? Kevin?
I just want to repeat something that Mr. Emmett was talking about earlier that I hope wasn't lost today, was Hanmer School becoming a school of distinction in the state of Connecticut. That's a terrific accomplishment that we should be, everyone in the town should realize this. So congratulations to Mrs. Akay, students and staff. It's a terrific accomplishment.
It really is. Anyone else? I'll make a comment. On Thursday, I attended the Keenan Kids Coalition meeting, and I'm not going to say a lot about it, but they do an awful lot. Right now, 750 kids are enrolled in our after-school programs. Everything from Comstock is teaching them how to garden, to robotics, to musical productions, Legos, and other kid-friendly things. They're doing a running club. They are an amazing group to work with, and I'll be periodically going to their meeting on Keenan Kids. But I did want to make a comment on a comment. A young gentleman got up, which I'm thrilled to hear our young students up there talking, and he said, if you have the heart, I can tell you from the people up on this table here that, yes, we have the heart. We don't have the money. And that's really what it boils down to. These are financial discussions we have. They're financial problems that we need to find solutions for. It has nothing to do with our desire to have what's best for the children, students of Wethersfield Public School. Whether it's pre-K
all the way up to senior year in high school. DECA, I mean, I'm just learning about it through a friend, Justin, who is, as I said, gave me his project. An amazing group. Did we undercut them? Yes. I think that was a terrible thing that happened, but it happened, and we really have to start working in a whole different mode with this financial situation the state has put us into. And the lacrosse people, can I just say, what a better way to do things than to do it together, collaboratively. We heard you. They came out to advocate for their students, for their children. They had a meeting today with administration and board, and that's how we're going to find solutions. I think we're actually looking at new models for how we move forward in Wethersfield, and I think we need to keep working that way. So, Jack, how's life at the high school?
Good. I just wanted to say something, you know, along the lines of the, you know, everything with the budget. And I think there's no one in this room that doesn't understand the, you know, the financial hardships that every community is going through, and especially with educational budgets. But, you know, to turn a positive spin on it, today was the largest number of people I've ever seen at a board of ed meeting, personally. And I think that showing that, you know, people do truly care about these new programs, and people do truly care about getting the money to DECA, and I get part of it was, you know, the whole thing with them not knowing, and that's, you know. But the fact that everyone cares so much, and the fact that everyone is willing to come to these meetings, and we're going to, and we get, you know, all these lacrosse players and all these people from DECA to come up and say stuff. That's not, you know, it's not an easy thing to do. I think it just shows a lot about our school community. And I do hope these programs work out. I do hope that we get a lacrosse program. I hope that DECA does go to nationals because, you know, both of these programs are, you know, lacrosse would be a great asset to our school community. And I know that DECA is a great asset to our school community. So I just hope everything works out with that. And I fully support those programs.
Okay. Thank you, Jack. That was a good spin on it. That was excellent. All right. May I have a motion to move to executive session for the purpose of discussion of the superintendent's 2016-17 goals? Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Any abstentions? Well, that concludes the public part of our board meeting, and I want to thank you all for coming and for watching. Good night.